Here's to the golden moon. Here's to the silvery sea. Most of all, here's a toast to you and to me. Breakfast with Bob.
Poncho Man. This is day two. Breakfast with Bob. My name is Bob Babbitt. We're brought to you by Hoka One One Polar, Halo Neuroscience, Velofix, Today's Plan, Normatec, Four Seasons Resort, Hualalai. And we are at beautiful Huggo's on the Rocks. Our next guest, who else goes and runs a 2:34:39 marathon at the end of an Ironman besides Mr. Matt Hanson, two-time winner Ironman Texas, four-time Ironman champion, three-time Ironman 70.3 champion. How you doing, Matt?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me back.
I'm really, when I see that, those type of splits, and it was most of the race with Ivan Tutikin?
Yeah, you know,
at Texas. We're talking Ironman Texas
this year. Didn't have the best swim. Got off a little bit too anxious.
Yeah.
And so I had some work to do coming out of the water to catch up with that main group. But, you know, I did quite a bit of work on the front of the main group for the last half of the race. A couple other guys came up and tried to break it apart, but you know, it was a flat and fast day. There was no wind, so it was really no opportunities to break the field up. So despite a number of efforts to split off from some of the faster runners, we all got off the bike within, you know, a couple seconds of each other. And I mean, there was, you know, six guys running low 240s that day.
Oh my God.
So, you know, it was, and I caught, you know, I had a slower transition than Ivan. He's an ITU boy, so he was out real quick. But I caught up with him about a quarter mile into the race, and I passed him, and you know, he kind of attached himself to my hip, and no matter, I thought that, you know, oh, 5 miles he'll be gone, 10 miles he'll be gone, 15 miles okay, why isn't he gone? But we were finally able to get a little gap at about mile 25 and a quarter.
Oh my God, it was that far down the line.
Yeah he was my shadow, closer than my shadow for the entire run.
So you go 7:39:25. He goes 7:39:57. Right?
Yes.
That's on 32 seconds in an Ironman.
Yeah.
Crazy. And races like that, I remember talking to both Cam Brown and Craig Alexander. They had a race like that in Melbourne where they're 2:37, 2:40 off the bike. And I think that race might have ended Crowey's Ironman career because he had done three world-class events really within 6 months. How hard was it for you to recover from that?
You know, physically, I came up surprisingly well. My bike came right back. You know, the run legs took a little while to come back, but mentally, it's just so hard that like to dial into that place and just to stay there for so long. And you know, the last couple miles got pretty ugly. There was a number of times where you're fighting off some demons in the last miles, you know, to get to the finish line. And you know, when you go to the well like that, it takes a while to mentally be willing to push yourself that deep again.
Right.
So, you know, it took me, you know, two or three more races before I got to the point where I felt like I was
back to yourself.
You know, I was having good swims, good bikes, and then I would get on the run and just kind of fall flat a little bit. You know, still run well, but not have the spark that I normally would. And,
right.
And that just comes from, you know, that desire to dig deep. And so, but I think we found it again.
So this race, obviously the most important race in the sport.
Exactly.
You haven't had a lot of success here yet.
Not yet.
Bike crash in a last year back a little bit.
Yeah.
We won't talk about that.
Yeah.
What have you done differently to focus on this?
So I've learned a lot from the last couple of years. Last year I didn't take a break over the summer or didn't take a big enough break over the summer. So I think I peaked in late September.
Yeah.
And trying to hold that level of fitness for an extra 2 weeks, just or 3 weeks, didn't work. And I ended up getting a cold about 2 weeks before the race, and wasn't able to shake that. Went to the doctor. You know, he's like, "Yeah, you've got a virus. Hopefully, you get better." And you know, I just didn't.
That's not helpful.
And you know, it took me almost 2 months after the race before that was gone. So I just. This year, I took a big break in the summer. I got to go and watch my wife race over in Germany and just relax a little bit and be her Sherpa.
Right.
And then came back to training feeling a little bit fresher, and you know, just had a very similar build to what I did in Ironman Texas, timing wise and everything. So you know, I think I raced 3 or 2 weeks ago at Augusta, just like I did 3 weeks before Texas this year. So really, you know, Texas, I thought I had the ideal build, so I tried to replicate that as much as possible, but just add the heat and humidity element that we didn't have this year in Texas.
So, but do you feel from your other races in your career that heat is something that you're okay with?
Yeah, I've done well in the heat in the past. Texas 15 was a nasty day.
Yeah, that was really hot.
You know, that wasn't much fun, but I was able to put together a really good day there. 17 and 18 there were quite cool. And so, but there's been some 70.3s that I've done well in the heat. Cartagena, I was able to take a win down there on a pretty miserable day. And then, you know, just recently in Augusta, I flatted, but I was riding really well and was still able to run a 111 flat. So, yeah, I think I've done things right in terms of heat prep this time around. Body feels good. Mind feels good. So
did you do a block here?
I didn't this year. I went with Coach Dibbins and Tio and Rennie.
We went
down to Kansas. Yeah, so we found a little hidden gem there in Lawrence, Kansas, and we were there for 3 weeks, just under 3 weeks, and had a good block there. Everybody asked why Kansas, but
I think it makes perfect sense. I think you want to be at sea level.
Yes,
and you want heat and you want wind.
Heat, wind, humidity, and just constant rolling hills. I mean, I don't think we found a flat stretch of road the entire time we were there.
That's funny. So you think Kansas flat?
Yeah,
but it's not.
You know, we the run trails we were on right on the river path were great because we could find flat stretches there, but on the bike, it's just constant rollers. Anybody who's done the old 70.3 course can attest to that. It's, you know, they go there thinking it'll be flat and fast, and it's anything but.
So do you look at anytime you go, you know, when you go 7:39, you have to look at that as your greatest race ever. But was there a race that meant more to you, or a race that early on told you that, you know, I could be good at this?
Yeah, I mean, I was still working full-time as a college professor in 2015.
You were a college professor?
Yeah.
What'd you teach?
Exercise science.
Oh, nice.
So I was
okay.
In charge of the exercise science department at Buena Vista University. And so I was still working full-time. And when I won Ironman Texas in 2015, that was a Saturday race. So I went back, did the award, the midnight awards, had a blast doing that, and then had to wake up early, do the award speech and everything.
Right.
And then I drove 17 and a half hours back home, got into the college at 7:45. I just went straight to the school, showered there, taught 8, 9, 10, 11 o'clock classes. And that was kind of the time that I'm like, okay, this is, I'm burning the candle at both ends here. And then 2 days later, I met with a student and was trying to help him set up a summer internship. And she was like, and I told her, I'm like, we want you to set up this internship so you can go after what you want most in life and put yourself in the best position. And I just kind of sat back, I'm like, kind of being a hypocrite here. Like, I love teaching, and I'm still connected with Buena Vista a little bit, but it was time to chase a dream. I felt then that I had the tools to be a world champion.
Right.
I had a lot to learn, and so I had to give everything. So at least when I'm, you know, 45 and can't keep up with these young bucks anymore, I can look back and know.
That you did.
That
you
I
did
gave everything that I had. Yeah.
What's your goal here?
My goal here this year is execute. I've had a couple rough races. You know, I've been on the island 4 times racing before, twice as an amateur, twice as a pro. And my best time, you know, where I finished as where I should have was the first time I was here when I knew absolutely nothing about the sport. It was my second triathlon. And so, you know, this year it's just about executing. On all three phases, nailing the nutrition, and then, you know, I think if I do that, I'll be at the pointy end when it matters, and then it's
if you're at the pointy end when it matters, and you're on this run course, people better look out.
I would hope so.
How about a round of applause for Matt Hanson, everybody? Good luck, man. Have
Thank
fun
you very
out
much.
There.
Thank you.
Here's to the golden moon. Here's to the silvery sea. Most of all, here's a toast for you and to me. At breakfast with Bob. Cheers.